minor nowadays. He's educated, and he's not a fond as hard work as the old miner was.
Traveling down that coal town road, listen to my rubber ties whine. And it's goodbye to Buckeye and White Sycamore. I'm leaving you behind. 'Cause I've been a coal miner all my life, laying down track in the hole. Got a back like an ironwood, bent by the wind, blood veins as blue as coal. Blood veins as blue as coal. Now somebody said that strange tattoo you got on the side of your head. I said that's the mark of a number nine coal. A little more and I'd be dead. But I love the rumble and I love the dark. I love the cool of the slate. But it's traveling down a new road, looking for a job. Traveling and looking ahead. Traveling and looking ahead. Well, I stood for the union. I walked on the line. Fought against company. And I stood for the UMWV. Always stood by me. But I got no home. Got no pay, just got a worried soul. And this blue tattoo on the side of my head, left by the number nine coal. By the number nine coal.
Most of miners nowadays, the old miner, it was all muscle power, hand work.
Yeah, I enjoyed it, because I'll tell you why. Each man, he was trying to see, could he outdo the other man, that he could load more coal than the other man could. And you was thinking the same thing. Hey, I'm going to beat him today, and he going to try to beat me today. Each man went in there with that thought. After each shift, he was bragged on. The women would give you more competition to go to work, man. Said, hey, you can get the average girl. Because her parents gonna tell them, say, that boy's a good coal loader, that boy's a powerful coal loader, and that's all they know. They didn't know anything yet.
I say the older miners had more pride in their work.
It was trade.
Yeah.
It was a trade then, George.
Yeah.
They went in there and they mined that thing to work site. They bore that thing and they kept the ribs straight. They had it timbered nicely, you know. They were proud of their place. In fact, when they sit down with a glass of rum, how is your room? How are you doing with your room? Oh, you want to see my room. And the other one, well, mine is better than yours. And if they're in the same section, they could walk in to make fun of one or something, wouldn't they?
How you work inside all day long. When you come out to hear that song, it's the coal miner boogie. It's the coal miner boogie. It's the coal miner boogie. And you boogie woogie all night long. Oh,
jeez. I grew up tough. You had to be tough to survive. You had to be greater than the other man to survive if you wanted to survive.
In fact, I never did think I would live to get this old. No. No other man. Because it was brutish work. It was muscle straining. It was back straining. It was nasty. Bad air. And the man didn't have no idea that he would live to get this old. No man that worked in no coal mines.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Any man that said he was never afraid in the coal mines is lying. This top right here will put the fear of God in you. It busts and it breaks. I mean, it's just a frightening experience to go through, but it's just part of coal mining.
When we take the coal out, the mountain would sit down. And when we'd hear these timbers cracking and a popping, maybe one would just crack here, and the minute we hear one over, we weren't worrying about that. But once you start popping and cracking like popcorn, we knew to back out. And whenever that started falling, it sounded like thundering, like a roaring, thundering a coming. And you see them our steel plates and things start popping and cracking, far flying.
And all at once there was a roar, and that all broke loose and caved in. But I was still alive, and I didn't know what happened to the other guys, see. There was a machine working below us, and I went down there and asked them fellas if they'd seen Jim. No, I didn't see Jim. I said, what happened? I said, the place caved in up there, and I think he's under. I think you caught him.
I heard somebody groaning, and I went to him. I couldn't see him, but I could feel him. I kept finding around to find him. I couldn't tell who it was. I seen he was bad hurt, and I looked for better air. I found it, dragged him into it. It was my boy. He come to me. I thought my time had come, and his too.
The original miners were mostly Irish, English, Scotch, and Welsh. And as time went by, they became very unhappy with the conditions under which they had to work. Finally, they would strike. Then the coal companies would go and they would recruit another group of workers. They sent headhunters to Italy, headhunters to Greece, headhunters to all of the Mediterranean and Eastern countries there. The men came and they had been told stories of road up these canyons were virtually paved with gold. They were going to receive these high wages. This was just a dream world. It didn't work that way.
My grandfather came here in 52. When he came here, you know, he couldn't, he was a foreigner. He couldn't talk English. So they let him go with somebody that couldn't talk very much either, you know. When he went to get his pay, he didn't know what the hell he was getting paid for, how much he was supposed to receive, right? So they beat him neck and necktie.
My dad couldn't defend himself because he didn't know the English language. My grandfather couldn't defend himself.
They would recruit Austrians, Czechs, Italians, Greeks, many, many different nationalities. Then once they got them into the mines and into the canyons, they attempted to keep them segregated. If the men couldn't communicate with each other, it was difficult for them to organize. In due time, they did learn to communicate, and they did get organized. And the many different ethnic groups brought strength to this union.
The union was built on a number of fine traditions. Tradition of solidarity, the tradition of an injury to one is an injury to all, a tradition of sticking together and being willing to fight for one another. It was also built on a tradition of change. The organization itself, its inception was a change. When two unions, the Knights of Labor and the National Federation of Miners, came together to form the United Mine Workers of America in 1890, in the original Constitution, our delegates adopted a provision that prohibited discrimination based on race, color, creed, national origin. Up until that point in time, the employers had always tried to play different groups off against one another. They understood, as long as they could divide us for any reason, that working people always lost and they always won.
You think this man is your enemy? This is a worker. Any union keeps this man out ain't a union. It's a goddamn club. Now they got you fighting white against colored, native against foreign, holler against holler. When you know there ain't but two sides of this world, them that work and them that don't. You work, they don't. We got to work together. till they can't get their coal out of the ground without us, because we're a union. And every man that walks out on his own steam, we take into the union.
All the Dagos and all the colored?
That's what a union is, fellas. You better get used to it.
To foster that coming together, our union used to print literature in its paper in several different languages, so that those that weren't fortunate enough to be able to understand English yet could understand about the union and how important it was for us to come together and not allow anybody or anything to divide us.
But today gives testament to the fact that they're never going to take us on alone again. We're in it together forever and ever.
We realized early on Pittston did not want a contract. The contract expired on February 1st of 88. Pittston cut off health care to the pensioners February 1st of 88. They eliminated arbitration, no way to settle disputes. And they ceased making contributions to the multi-employer health and retirement plan. We worked 14 months without a contract and without striking. On April 5th of 89, we went on strike. Pittston wanted one, we gave them one. But it wasn't the one they were looking for.
I'd like to see a good, decent contract for our fellow man and restoring of the health benefit to the pensioners, the widows, and their children.
I think it's very unfortunate Pittston would treat their people that really made them money in the past, and when they get to the point where they have no benefit to them, why, they cast them aside like they're not human anymore.
Are you union? Yeah! Are you union? Yeah!
We're going to sit together. We're not going to give up. That's one thing for sure.
Battle lines are drawn, and we're going to win this strike.
It's Air Jobs, Air Town. The union's here to stay.
Union, 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 union.
I started in the mining business, not in the business itself, as a miner at the age of 13. Actually, I was so young, I was afraid of the dark.
Well, I started the mines 2 months before I was 16 years old, at Loash Shaft Mines, loading coal and a big slate, big rock, and no air, and you had to push the cars, sit down and kick them in, kick them out. And my back had hurt me so bad till I hunted for a high place.
Breaker boy, breaker boy. Does your mama pray? Is your dad around and bent, digging coal all day? The black gold suck the breath from you, is life the price you pay? Is that how it's with you, breaker boy?
I went to work when I was 10 years old, picking slate in the coal burger. Well, at that time, we were working 10 hours a day, and we were getting 6 and a fraction cents an hour. Well, we breaker boys, we'd have our feet in the chute, and we'd be picking the slate out. Well, the breaker boss would sneak up behind us, and if he'd see a piece of slate coming through, he'd pick up the slate and hit you in the back with it, and hit you hard. And he'd say, pick that slate out, you know? Well, they used to abuse us, actually. Well, finally, we got to a stage where we figured that, well, we was gonna strike. We said, to hell with the agreement. We're going to stay out and strike until we get our demands. Well, then the politicians began visiting us and putting pressure on us. Then the parish priest. Well, finally, the coal company did agree to meet with us. And they agreed to raise the hourly pay from 6 and a fraction cents to 8 cents an hour. Well, this was my first lesson that if you stuck to your organization and stuck together, in solidarity, you could defeat them. Johnny Mitchell, who at that time was the president of the United Mine Workers, He come into the Anthracite area in 1900, and he began to select organizers, and that they began to go around into the mine patches, visiting the miners, and develop their understanding of the reasons why they needed a union, and at the same time, how the union should be built and how it should be organized. Well, about 1902, on the 1st of April, he was in a position, he believed he had enough organization developed that they could carry on a successful strike, and they proceeded to strike. Well, that strike went on for 6 months, and it was a terrific battle. The Coal and Iron Police and the state militia was used against the miners, and the miners fought back.
The bituminous miners, seeing the threat to themselves through their anthracite brothers, assessed themselves 10% of their salary. It was the first UMWA strike fund that we'd ever known. The assessment helped the anthracite brothers sustain themselves and ultimately win a great victory for the mine workers. It represents the first time that the United Mine Workers called on the federal government to intervene to help settle a strike.
Well, Teddy Roosevelt at that time was the president, and he set up a commission. And in this commission that they set up, they began to investigate the conditions of the miners. The commission came to the conclusions that the miners had the right to have a union.
The coal companies built the school, they hired the school teachers. The coal companies built the church, they hired the minister. The minister served the company. He could not address the social wants and needs of the miners.
The law enforcement officials were either controlled or influenced greatly by the company, so that what you had in those communities was almost a complete control of the lives, both working lives and community lives, of the coal miners.
They had a big company store and a big company saloon. They could charge you whatever they wanted, and you were always in the red with them.
You trade there or else. You trade into the company stores or down the canyon you go.
They wouldn't pay you nothing but scrip. People had to spend their money at the company store here.
The people up there, their living conditions and so forth were such that they didn't believe in American money. They believed more in the company scrip system. That the kids didn't even know what American money was. And I had an affidavit there where this guy had made the statement that in one whole year he had not drawn $1 of American money as payment for his wages.
Because they take your carbide, you take your powder, they take your groceries, what you bought. Everything came out of there in the statement, lights and all and everything. House rent, everything if you rented a house. They take everything before you send your statement. Statement A, sometimes you got $1, $1.50, sometimes you got a snake. And that happened many a times.
What?
A snake. Nothing coming. Company kept it all.
And then in a mine, why, when they had a lot of brushing to do, timbers to set and stuff like that, well, they'd tell them that they'd straighten it out with them every 15 days. They'd come around and put it down in your book, what you done. Any rock you moved or brushing you done, track you laid, payday come around, you never did get any. Well, if you hollered, all they'd do is tell you, put your tools on and take off.
Company weighed the coal. We didn't know how much it weighed. We didn't have a check weighman. I think there was an antique law that said you were entitled to a check weighman, but God help you if you tried to get one because you didn't have any union to represent you.
If your car went out and they found a chunk of rock all big as a silver dollar around, and that thick, the first time they fined you 50 cents. The second time, if they found any rock in your coal like that, they charged you $1. The third time, put your tools on the car, you're through. You cleaned that coal for nothing.
If a mule was accidentally killed,
boy, you got hell.
You got hell, and they closed that end of the mine down.
Let a mine man get hurt, they say, oh, well, they'll hire another Mexican.
That's right.
That's just the way it happens, fellas.
There was no respect given at all.
What about me? The rock and falling on me. He said, we can always hire another man, since you've got to buy that mule. In other words, you thought more of the mule than did a man.
Whenever you
didn't want you to have any meetings. Like I said, they had their balling thugs or their police force that would see to it that there wasn't no meetings.
I remember they had this gathering on a Sunday afternoon, and George Lavender got up on this high stump to make his speech where he could be up over the crowd, you know. And they arrested him and took him away. And he got 6 months for making a public speech on the company property.
If you mentioned United Mine Workers at that time, they would beat your brains out, take you and throw you off to camp, you and your family.
People were kicked out of their homes, and people actually starved to death or froze to death in the winter.
All the miners that lived in this town were evicted, and they lived in a tent colony on the other side of the hill up there on one of the miners' properties up there. And then after the strike was over, miners were able to move back into their homes. But they used even the home to try to discipline you.
You people have been put out of Stone Mountain Mine housing. And some of you have seen fit to take along food, furniture, and clothing that don't belong to you but belong to the company. As of the day of the strike, your scrip ceased to be legal tender, meaning that any item of food, clothing, and furniture not paid for in cash money must be turned over to me. We got the law on our side.
You ain't no law. You got to slip around the real law. You just got guns is all. You just thugs.
How come you hired gun thugs to harass us around with? You saying there that the issue is for a no-strike clause. Well, if we had a no-strike clause in there, Norman Yarbrough could kick us off of that hill and there wouldn't be a thing we could do about it. But I tell you, we are in Harlan County, all of our life we've been kicked around, we've been put in jail, we've been shot at, we've had dynamite thrown at us, and then you don't want us to have nothing. Well, I tell you, Mr. Horn, I'm gonna be standing right there on that picket line looking at you just as long as it takes.
Bob, are you gonna be there?
Where?
It's picket line high street.
Y'all don't know what y'all are going up against up there. The thugs that's sitting there in the highway with guns in their hands. We can't do nothing except get up there and wiggle.
Well, how do you feel about it, Tommy? I mean, how do you feel about us coming up there?
Well, I'm afraid too, but I grew up there.
It's pretty shaky up there.
I can remember when they organized these mines down here. I was just a little old boy, and people walking the railroad tracks and stuff with high-powered rifles and stuff like that. Had the same deal, just like it. This has been just a little bit more sophisticated than it was back years ago, you know. Well, it's like these people here, they're sophisticated thugs, and them back in them days, well, they're just plain outlaws, you know.
Miners and violence are nothing new to the coal fields, but even long-time miners, veterans of all types of labor disputes over the years, tell us they have never witnessed the kind of violence that took place up this road here today.
Looks as a massacre to me.
They were ambushed from behind. The scabs come up behind them. Ambushed them. It's cold-blooded murder. That's all in the hell it is.
John McCoy was killed on a protest line. The coal operators came up the road, started shooting into the woods. The men started higher up on the hill, and when they did, they run into an ambush, which John McCoy was shot 3 times. Two other brothers, one of them was shot 4 times, the other one was shot twice.
From what we could tell, the vehicles possibly parked on that road when they were shot.
By mid-afternoon, police were still combing the hillside just below the mine, gathering evidence. This bullet was recovered from a tree atop the hill where police believe one or more gunmen were stationed.
It's sad that it has to come to one of our fellow workers has to suffer like this to fight, to get what their parents has fought for years ago and to keep it. And it's a sad moment.
This solemn occasion speaks forcefully of our mortality. For man that is born of woman is full of trouble and sorrow. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. Our years of labor are brought to an end.
People with money think they can buy what they want. Norfolk Harlem cannot be bought. It's already paid for by union labor. Our grandfathers worked there, our fathers died there. The Harlem has always been union. There's no race, there's no black, there's no white, there's one race, union.
We're out to win this. We're out to win it for the American worker. But the big corporations right now don't give a damn about us. We'll lay in the road. We'll use it every means of nonviolence, whatever it takes.
I was scared of those trucks, I'll be honest with you, because I know they would have ran over us now. There's no doubt in my mind. If they got you in a spot they could have, they would have went over top of you.
I tried to keep the history of the strike on videotape, and so I'll get ready to tape the 6 o'clock news. So help me goodness, here they're talking about the Pittston headquarters building being taken over in Lebanon. And I look, and that's Diane! And there was my sister. They had the doors changed saying, ladies, this is your last chance. We're asking you to leave now. And here they are singing and Diane with a big smile on her face. And I thought, is she not listening to this man? Diane's husband calls and he says, the women taking over the Pittston headquarters.
When we first went into the Pittston building, had a sit-in. It was 39 women went in there. And everybody, I believe, was a little bit scared. I mean, we didn't know where we'd be put in jail or what. And through the whole thing, I mean, it took courage to do it. We started out, we wanted to show our husbands solidarity. And we felt like that to show them if they went to jail, we'd go to jail too. We had no intentions of telling our names to the police if they arrested us. So one of the ladies said, okay, what did we tell the police when they arrest us? And we just come up with, well, let's just say we're the daughters of Mother Jones, because we had talked about Mother Jones and how courageous she was, and we tried to model ourselves after her.
She was just a short old lady. I don't think she was just about, not even 5 feet tall. But she was powerful, believe me.
She was a good fighter for laboring men, and she was fighting for labor all the time, with Mother Jones. And of course, she may have done not done no dirty dishes, but she sure done a lot of good work for the union.
She was all union for the union all the way through, by golly.
when she had made a speech, everybody knew it because she cussed like hell. Didn't care what she said.
Back then, you know, we weren't used to a whole lot of profane language, you know, and all that stuff, and boy, she laid it on them.
She'd talk to the women about trying to stimulate the men enough to be in an active unionist and try to drive her to win the strike.
Whether it was beating on pans to scare the mules and all for, and the scabs, they was a little afraid of her too. It was something that they'd never seen before. Women coming at them with mops or pans beating on them and all, you know. And I could understand that it would scare you. I mean, you'd be going to work and here come an army of women with mops and brooms. You know they're gonna clean up something. She lived to be 100 years old, so she's probably enjoyed her work. She didn't die from an ulcer. And I'd have just loved to have been with her.
One of her famous sayings were, "Let's all pray for the dead and fight like hell for the living." Mary Mother Jones has stood side by side with the miners in Alabama, West Virginia, of course, Illinois. Mother Jones not only stopped at Verdun, she went to Ludlow, Colorado, helping the coal miners in their desperate times.
She was a nice lady as far as I was concerned, and we worked together. We went from place to place, wherever had a local union that was out on a strike.
The organization of the Southern Colorado Field took a matter of many, many months. They were going up against a tough customer in John D. Rockefeller and his Western managers, and the Victor American Fuel and the other coal companies. The operators were strong and they were united.
And so I keep talking to the miners and let's do something, gotta do something. This thing is no good. Well, we had a convention of the coal miners of the entire state and decided, and the company won't meet us and won't do anything about it. And they, in this convention, they decided to have a strike.
It was early spring, strike was on. Drove us miners out of doors, out from the houses that the company owned. Moved in the tents of little Ludlow.
The unions were prepared to have their people evicted from the coal camps. And in advance, they had purchased tents and stoves and everything to set up tent colonies down on the prairies on free ground that was not company ground. On October 17th, CF&I's death special engaged the tent colony at Forbes. Striker was killed, young girl shot in the face, and a boy hit 9 times in the legs as he tried to crawl to safety.
That was the day that they first shot in the tent colony. Well, we got off the train then that day. Yeah, we had bought a whole lot of things, and Dad said, don't worry about them, just throw them in the creek and go down and lay low. You know, when they were shooting?
Yeah.
And he was with me, you know. He said, don't care, we can buy more.
The miners were armed as swiftly as the UMWA could purchase rifles. Most of the guns used were Winchester 30-30s.
Yeah, 30-30s. I help unpack them and everything. As kids, us kids was into everything, you know. And every time they'd shoot a scab, we'd run down and see. And I seen some bloody heads and some dead ones and all
you
that.
Know, Mike Lavora has one of those 30-30s.
Fight broke out Monday morning. And by 2 o'clock, I had a little better than 100 men. Only about a mile and a half from Ludlow, but we couldn't get back into Ludlow because Ludlow was surrounded by guards.
I heard it was going to happen by that railroad man. That was at night. See, I was coming from the show. It was pretty late. He said, I seen them planting machine guns. It was a moonlight night, see, along the railroad track. Well, the railroad track, if you notice down there, right here, well, that tent colony was right here, see? Right in here in the railroad track here. He said they was planting machine guns along here.
that there 90 soldiers waited till us minds was asleep. They stuck around our little penthouse, soaked our tents with your kerosene. You struck a match and the blaze had started. Well, the fears of the Gatling guns, I made a run for the children, but the fire won't stop me. 13 children died from your gun.
I was under the water tank waiting for a freight train. Bullet hit the rail, glanced from the rail, and come back and hit me in the heel.
That's when I got a shot, too. I got a scar here.
The women and children had that big hole dug under a tent, and they were in there, and there were 14 of them, women and children, in there, and there was a couple of men in there. Well, they finally set that tent on fire, but before they did this, Tychus, he was a Greek, wanted to have them honor the women and children for their safety. And he started over, and he had a white flag on a little stick. And they kept telling him, come on, come on. They talked to him, and he got close enough, they killed him.
Well, we stopped there as long as we could till they kind of let up on the battle, kind of quieting down. Then I went to Trinidad to Dr. Beshoyer. He was the Union doctor.
They would report that they saw dead bodies everywhere. They saw the colony being burned. They said, for God's sake, somebody get in and help these poor people at Ludlow.
Well, we went down the next day. There was nothing but smoke and ruins and old coal stoves, bed springs, bedsteads, and things sticking out all over the place. Looked like a graveyard.
I didn't know how many people were killed till the thing was almost a week or 2 weeks over. Yeah. See, there was about 20 killed on the company side, 13 on our side. That is that day. Two women and all those kids were suffocated to death.
We were given these white crosses in Greenwich, Connecticut, just before we went to Pittston headquarters. And we were asked to write down the name of someone that we knew personally that had been a casualty or a fatality of the mines. And these are my uncles, my mother's brothers. I looked over there at that pretty Connecticut green manicured grass, and there was Pittston's officials looking out the windows. They had police there at the doors. There was no trespassing signs up everywhere. And I thought about Arlington with all those crosses so perfectly positioned. And I thought, we were asked to put only one name on a cross, just one. And I looked at my cross, and I looked at my sister's cross, and I noticed other people couldn't put just one name. And that was my family, my neighborhood, my community. And where I teach school, I thought about how many children were left without fathers or grandfathers.
Hey, my hair is gone. We'll see him no more. God be with the miner wherever he goes. And may he be ready thy call to obey. And looking to Jesus, the only
we are here to show tribute to Sid Hatfield, the police chief of Mate 1 during the early 1944. 1900s and 1920 mine wars. Doesn't history repeat itself? As we sit here today and look at what was faced by Sid Hatfield and others at that time. This was one of the first challenges of John L. Lewis and his reign as president of the Union.
About June 1920, the coal operator sent a bunch of Baldwin Phelps, they called themselves. We called them Baldwin Thugs. To mate one, and they started up Red Jacket Holler, setting people out of their homes. Well, all the home a coal digger ever knowed then was a coal camp home, a coal camp house. And they started them up there throwing people out of their houses. Well, that lasted till about 4 o'clock in the evening, 16, the mail train was due. About the same time a shooting match started.
Y'all have no right to come to this here town with all these people and drawing guns and terrorizing. The writs you have are not valid for this town. You can't get away with this. No! Wait, no!
They killed 11 of them in Matewan there that evening, and the 12th one said he stayed in the rain barrel till after midnight that night and crawled out and got away. They didn't get him. I always hated that.
The Matewan massacre gave the strikers something to rally around. This time, they took the offensive. They became more militant and determined to win the strike. A form of guerrilla warfare broke out that summer and continued in the fall and winter of 1920 and 21. In January of 1921, Sid and Ed Chambers and other miners who were involved in the Matewan massacre were tried for the murder of the Baldwin Phelps detectives in their home county of Mingo. And the jury acquitted all of them on the grounds, I believe, they felt the Baldwin Phelps detectives had it coming to them.
They indicted Sid Hatfield up at Welsh for blowing a tipple up at Mohawk. But he didn't blow it up. He wasn't guilty of it. But they wanted to get rid of him because he's organizing the miners against the coal operators. And when he come up there to Welsh, they went to the hotel, come the night before and went to the hotel, and they put their guns and left them in the hotel. And at about 10 o'clock that morning, next morning, they went down there and went up to the courthouse to answer to the indictment, and Baldwin Phelps killed them. That's just that they got to the top of the steps going in on the level sidewalk.
So I immediately pulled the door to and just ran right up there because, like a boy, I wanted to see what was going on and what was happening. So I went up and one fella had fallen down the steps into the what they call a pit where you turn in off of Wyoming Street up the steps. And the first landing, there was a man dead there and a woman leaning over him crying.
So they took them down there and laid them out there, and they put guns in their hands and took pictures of them laying in the street with guns in the hand. Neither one of them had a gun.
Well, what you have to understand is how the miners themselves felt about Sid Hatfield. Keep in mind, he's a very young man, 28 years old, and he was recognized at that early age as a hero of the Union's cause and the working class people's cause. And he was an elected official also, and highly popular, very charismatic individual. So when he died, the word spread quickly about his murder. Emotions were running very high, and the miners were very angry, and there was a discussion of forming a march to clean out Mingo County, set free all those union organizers who were being held in jails in Mingo County and other places in southern West Virginia. There was also a discussion about cleaning out Logan County and hanging old Don Chafin, who was the sheriff of Logan County, from a sour apple tree, as the miners put it.
I've seen cars go across down at Davie, the lower end of Davie there, across the railroad and over toward Wyoming County and into Blair all day long. Just one car right to another with four or five men in it and their rifles going to war.
I don't know, there were thousands
from around here, but they was coming in from Illinois, Pennsylvania, and Ohio, the miners was. And they told the government if they didn't open up Logan County that they was going to open it up themselves and blow it away.
Old men, young men, and middle-aged men, men with automatic, the latest rifles that you could buy, and men with old muzzle loaders.
Some of them had on their service uniforms, OD uniforms. And most of them had on coveralls, and they had a red bandana handkerchief around their neck. I remember that. And for that reason, they called them rednecks. They had about 2,000 or 3,000 men on top of the hill entrenched in with machine guns all along the top of the hill. And that my cousin had told me that they wasn't going to let anybody pass. They're going to kill every fellow that attempted to cross that mountain.
Talking about shooting, you couldn't hear your ears for the bullets. Couldn't hear nothing else, only shooting. It was just like bumblebees or honeybees are flying in there. Now that's about how it went.
We stayed pretty close during all that time. You never knew when the shooting was going to start or stop. And everybody had that had a basement. Certainly, they got a lot of use during this time.
By Thursday, September 1st, the miners believed that they could indeed go all the way. They had 10,000 men, three times the number that Chaffin had on his defensive line. They thought they could storm up Blair Mountain through Logan, perhaps all the way to Mingo County. They were in control of some 500 square miles of southern West Virginia. They operated the trains. They controlled the school buildings. They confiscated automobiles. They were in command. They were not about to turn back as they had done before. They were willing to put the test to President Harding's ultimatum.
Was out in the yard. We was all out in the yard playing around. That's when my father was on this march. And there were two, I guess they were World War I planes. They were small planes. But that's the first time I ever saw an airplane in my life. And first time I ever heard the word bomb. I had this stand, we was out gawking, as kids was at that, and some old lady there close by hollers, they're gonna bomb us.
The company bombed us, the thugs. They made their own bombs. The deputy sheriff made their own bombs, dropped them out of the air from airplanes. That was John Chaffin over there, the sheriff. He had money to do that kind of stuff with. Then the regular army came in, and they brought a special train up to Blair. And they talked to my brother, and he told all the men, that was all the miners, to turn their guns over to federal authorities. He said, the federal authorities here, we're not going to violate federal laws. And had a meeting, a speech, and told them, and they turned their guns over. There was about a 40-ton car of guns, different kinds of guns, that they turned over to the federal government. When the federal government asked them to quit, they quit instantly, because nobody wanted to fight the government. We was only fighting thugs.
And that was one of the most significant events in the United Mine Workers' history in southern West Virginia. And the miners considered that a victory because they had made the United States government come to southern West Virginia and say, we're here to keep the peace. They felt that was a victory. What makes someone say, I'm going up this mountain and let someone shoot at me with a machine gun because of what I believe? It wasn't to get money. It wasn't for profit. It was because they believed in what they were doing.
Well, I believe it to be a historical event. All my life growing up here, I've heard about the Miners' March in 1921, seen it on films, pictures on TV, heard about it from my uncles and my father.
We're doing this non-violent. The last time this march took place, they was violent. Now we're going to do it non-violent and see how it works.
It's the same type of mentality that's trying to control America as it controlled then. And we're just going to have to work our way through the paperwork world instead of the way they did it years ago when they took the law in their own hands.
Cape Breton, Nova Scotia is a lot like other North American coal fields. It was populated by immigrants, mostly from Scotland and a bit of the Irish too. A critical time in our Union's history in Canada was the early 1920s when the Cape Breton miners were in rebellion against the British Empire Steel Corporation. BESCO owned nearly everything in Nova Scotia then, the mines, the steel mills, the seaports, and the politicians. When the UMWA went on strike during this period to end the company's slave labor conditions, thousands of coal miners and their families were jailed and beaten, and they experienced murder at the hands of the company police. That's why the 11th of June is a special day for Canadian members of the United Mine Workers in Cape Breton. We call it Davis Day, named after Billy Davis, a rank-and-file coal miner who was murdered by the coal police on that day in 1925. We remember the sacrifice of Bill Davis because it represents the true price of coal.
John L. Lewis was a very strong union leader, and as a result, he evoked very strong opposition at times. In 1926, John Brophy challenged John L. Lewis for the presidency of the organization. Brophy called for nationalization of the mines. He called for a third party. He called for organizing the unorganized. And he called for doing it with the members of the union, local members, members of the district, and the international, all forming together to have a great organizing push. Lewis crushed him in the 1926 election. But that didn't end Brophy's career. Lewis so respected him that he brought him back into the ranks and he named him the head of the Congress of Industrial Organization. Brophy's leadership qualities complemented Lewis thereafter. The 20s were a very, very hard time for labor and the UMWA specifically. The demand for coal that was brought about by World War I had dropped off. There was massive unemployment. The first appearance of mechanization took over, and our membership went from a high of 500,000 down to less than 100,000 members. Employers seized on the opportunity to try to eliminate the United Mine Workers. They were bad times. And then the Depression hit.
To the American people, the Depression of the early 1930s was an economic disaster with no rightful place in a nation potentially able to supply the needs of half a world. To millions, it was deep tragedy, near starvation, dependence on charity, an endless search for a non-existent job.
Herbert Hoover leaves the White House for the last time as president to share the car of America's president-elect in the traditional ride down Pennsylvania Avenue to the steps of the Capitol and inauguration ceremonies. A nation in the depths of economic depression had elected its first Democratic chief executive in 12 years, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, whose spirit and eloquence restored the hopes of 140 million Americans.
So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
In 1933, with Franklin Roosevelt taking a positive attitude towards organizing the unorganized, organizers went telling miners that the president wants you to join the union. That basically opened the door. I believe they always wanted to belong to the union, but were afraid of being fired, discriminated against, possibly even kicked out of their homes for joining the union. But this opened the door and let them know it was all right, that their government thought it was all right to belong to a union.
In 1934, American workers reformed their ranks on the U.S. labor front. With new unrest came the reappearance of the professional strikebreaker, whose squads of plug uglies were available on short notice for settling labor disturbances.
Organized labor. Feller, it's been a fight all the way. Y'all know that. When I went to work in the coal mines, they'd tell me, you do this, you do that. And I'd say, no, it ain't safe. They'd say, get your bucket and go home. We got a man outside waiting on your job. Water didn't mean nothing. Bad top didn't mean nothing. Or bad air didn't mean nothing. Anything that they could get by with, they got by with it. Until the United Mine Workers come in here. John L. Lewis come to Clinchfield, and they walked the roads, marching up through Bunchtown, huffing and a puffing like a big bulldog with his shirt sleeve rolled up, and said, boys, it's time to go to work. We're going to organize this place.
And the workers of this country want representation. They want organization. They want participation. They want protection. They want employment. And they're going to have those things through the leadership and the instrumentality of this new labor movement that you're forging.
Breaking with his old colleague William Green, John L. Lewis began battling for the wholesale organization of labor in mass industries, without regard for AF of L's designations of trade or craft.
The American Federation of Labor must undertake to so revise its policy that it can welcome the admission of these millions of workers into the industrial form of organization for which they clamor.
Such action constitutes a challenge to the supremacy and authority of the American Federation of Labor and cannot and will not be tolerated.
Lewis, he had more vision than any of the other labor leaders of his time. He had the vision to bring people together in the CIO. He organized millions of workers because he realized that the mine workers' flanks were exposed. If steel or auto or rubber weren't organized, the mine workers, who had common employers, our flanks were exposed. And by organizing those people, not only was he doing what was right and strengthening the labor movement, but he was also protecting the mine workers.
By 1936, the CIO had armies of organizers in every major industry. Lewis had expected the big breakthrough in steel. He was wrong. The United Auto Workers were signing thousands of men. The break came one day in December. Workers at the Fisher Body Plant punched in as usual. An ordinary day. Then something happened. The workers had sat down. They would not work, and they would stay in the factory until General Motors signed a contract with their union.
We devised Operation Flintstone, I guess, in honor of our brothers and sisters from Flint, Michigan in 1937, which was a very successful sit-in. And we took something old and modernized a little bit and brought it up to 1990, and it worked very well.
John L. Lewis did this. And that is what this falls back on, and I feel if he could do it, we can do it.
We had to recruit. The recruiting process was very difficult. Because you had to recruit people without telling them what they were going to do. The main pitch to those prospective candidates was that we are planning to do something in the very near future. It could be dangerous, and we may be arrested. But if you're arrested, the staff person assigned to your group will be the last one out of jail. We'll be with you every step of the way.
When he left, he says, don't ask where I'm going or what I'm doing or when I'll be back, because I really don't know.
We pulled up to the gate, and everyone got into their formations. We had three teams, a red team, a white team, and a blue team. I was up front, and we just walked in.
We are unarmed, and we are owners of this company. Stop right here.
That first 15, 30 seconds across the bridge and toward the plant was scary. We were greeted by two security guards, and I immediately moved toward the guards and explained to them that we were a group of stockholders and that we were going in to inspect our investment.
This is a peaceful takeover. No one will be harmed. We're asking you to leave now.
How long are y'all prepared to stay for?
As long as it takes.
As long as it takes.
Union members say this means enough is enough. They've had it with courts clamping down on their strike tactics and no progress in contract talks.
As we picket at the bridge, we go to jail. We get on the road, we go to jail. There's no place left.
This is it.
We're cooperating fully with the appropriate state and federal officials. in dealing with this latest act of violence by the union.
Pittston violated the law in collective bargaining with the National Labor Relations Board, and we are just here to try to make them abide by the law. It's clearly nonviolent, and it's going to stay that way.
Striking United Mine Workers who own stock in Pittston Coal Company continued the fourth day of their takeover of the Moss No. 3 preparation plant today.
Ten Charbreaker Man.
He wants his daddy home.
I guess that there's a good chance that somewhere around tomorrow or late tonight that there'll be somebody looking to take me away, but that's all right. Don't worry about that. We've got some excellent leaders here. We've got a plan. If I go and John goes and Jackie goes, there's somebody going to step right into their shoes.
But they're going to show up some point in time. I don't know if it's going to be tonight or in the morning or sometime in the middle of the night. I'm sure they'll show up.
Is it going to be violent or is everything going to stay under control?
It's going to stay under control, totally non-violent.
And an order that basically said you had to be out of here by 7 o'clock. I think it's about 7:45 right now.
Right.
You got the coal stopped, you got the scabs gone.
Yep.
They got all these great laws. Now they can figure out how to enforce them when they fill up all these jails around here. That's just about the way I've got this thing figured.
The attempts of the General Motors Corporation to intimidate the men who are on strike through the use of injunctions, tear gas, police forces, will not avail them. The nearly 2 million workers who are associated with the Committee for Industrial Organization will support the men in the automobile industry to the fullest extent of their moral and their financial support.
We may compare John L. Lewis to Mussolini, the arrogant and unscrupulous dictator, of whom it has been said that at times he suffers from a rush of blood to his head. Like a volcano, he spouts flame and burning lava.
Don't you know that you're applauding a dictator? You've actually wasted more energy in this convention this afternoon standing up and shouting and marching around the convention than the American Federation of Labor has expended in 57 years.
Finally, the Federation demands that the CIO be disbanded or take the consequences.
But Mr. Lewis, the American Federation of Labor has threatened to suspend you. Won't they have to do something to save their face?
Who says they have a face?
Suspended by the Federation are all 10 unions in the CIO, more than one-third of the Federation's entire membership.
The American Federation of Labor can help if it will. It can oppose if it may, but we shall carry on.
December 7th, 1941, a day of infamy. Even as Japanese diplomats were conferring with Secretary of State Hull on peace measures, Nipponese planes were swooping down on Pearl Harbor. Within hours, the United States declared war. In the explosions at Pearl Harbor, there was forged the will for complete and absolute victory over the forces of evil.
After the attack at Pearl Harbor, the three great labor organizations gave the positive assurance that there would be no strikes as long as the war lasted. The president of the United Mine Workers of America was a party to that assurance.
Yes, I'm wondering, Senator, where the war is today. And apparently, we have plenty of aid to give stricken peoples anywhere in the world except in the mining regions of this country. Whenever the government will give guarantees that they will protect our people in the South from starving and that they will get food, that they'll be protected against evictions from their homes, that their civil liberties will be protected from the hired gunman in the South, the United Mine Workers of America will hold a meeting of their policy committee, and I will recommend immediately that all the mines in this country go to work where the operator of that mine will agree to sign this agreement.
coal will be mined no matter what any individual thinks about it. It is inconceivable that any patriotic miner can choose any course other than going back to work and mining coal.
In war, labor must do most of the work and do most of the dying. On Tuesday, March 25th, disaster occurred at the Centralia No. 5 mine in Centralia, Illinois. 111 coal miners were killed in this explosion. They left 98 widows, and they left 78 orphans. Is it any wonder that the widows in the mining camps now are reluctant to see their men go to the mines next week when the memorial period is over? If we must grind up human flesh and bones in the industrial machine that we call modern America, then before God I assert that those who consume the coal and you and I who benefit from that service because we live in comfort, we owe protection to those men first, and we owe the security for their families if they die. I say it, I voice it, I proclaim it, and I care not who in heaven or hell opposes it.
The new soft coal walkout follows a dispute over a union demand for old age pensions for miners. Chief of the United Mine Workers, John L. Lewis, has written a letter stating that the companies have refused to concede the pensions, whereupon soft coal diggers leave their jobs. 200,000 the first day of the walkout.
John L. started setting up a health benefit and a pension plan for us. John L. Lewis cared for his men. He fought for his men. That's the reason we stood up and fought and backed him. You know, if you ain't got a leader, you got a mob. And he was a leader.
That's a 40-year-old pen. Well, it means a whole lot to them. And I worked 40 years for it. Well, see, I retired from Island Creek Coal Company, but I'm with the rest of the guys that, you know, for Piston. I'm 100% for our union, and that's the reason I go with it. If Piston that does the miners now, Island Creek's going to be the next, and that's going to be my check. And that's the reason I get out. I'm out every day with them.
Piston turned around, and they notified me about a week before the contract run out. That was in 88, January 88. They said, Mr. Whitaker, as of February the 1st, you have no more health benefits.
There will be a fight when next we negotiate like you've not seen before, because the employers will demand that we jettison the pensioners, and with equal fervor and hopefully more force, we will demand that they provide health care to them. And that will be a battle that will be a long one.
My daddy could always do anything and everything. And to me, he never got old. And during the strike and talking about health benefits and everything, all of a sudden I looked at him and I saw him as old and worn out, and I knew that the mines had done it and that Pittston had got the best part of his life.
Oh yeah, they'll take everything they can from a miner. Took my health card away from me.
Went to my place and I looked in, the slate and the water up to my chin. I got the blues, I got the blues, I got the blues, Lord, Lord. Coal black, mine and blue. Looked at my boss and he looked sad. The worst dang place that I ever had. I got the blues, I got the blues, I got the blues, Lord, Lord. Coal black, mine and blue. I'm pretty hoarse. Seem like I can't get it back. And it's all over coal mine. Black lung.
This is one of your brother's lungs. And this is what it looks like at autopsy. And this is why he died.
I know there's something wrong, but I didn't know what it was. Well, you just couldn't get no breath. You'd walk a little piece and you'd give out. Just panting for breath. And sometimes you couldn't hardly get it no way.
We think that the best informed medical opinion will show you that it's not true that the inhalation and retention of coal dust in the lungs necessarily results in any impairment of pulmonary function.
A man goes in the mine for 20 years. He comes out of that coal mine and to walk down the street in Williamson or the shopping mall, he has to have a bottle of oxygen in a shopping cart in front of him. Somebody owes that man something.
A miner's life is like a sailor's board a ship across the wave. Every day his life's in danger, still he ventures being brave. Watch the rocks, they're falling daily. Careless miners always fail. Keep your hand upon the dollar and your eye upon the scale. Union miners stand together, heed no operator's tale. Keep your hand upon the dollar and you'll ride upon the scale.
Washington is under a virtual state of siege during the closing hours of the Taft-Hartley labor bill fight, as forces of labor staged last-minute demonstrations to defeat the measure. At the White House, President Truman, after long deliberation, gives his reasons for vetoing the measure.
I had hoped that the Congress would send me a labor bill I could sign. But the Taft-Hartley bill is a shocking piece of legislation.
We submit that it's unfair. We submit further that on the face of the record made here, that it's impossible for the United Mine Workers of America to accept any responsibility for the killing of men in this industry unless the Congress should modify the Taft-Hartley Act that gives us liberty of action, because that liberty of action does not now exist.
Lewis calls the law the first ugly thrust of fascism in America, demands the Federation boycott the law. When the AFL rejects his demand, Lewis's answer is blunt. We disaffiliate.
They took away our rights to sympathy strikes. They took away our rights to sign contracts that would require a new mine when it opened up to be under our banner. They took away the right to engage in boycotts and to aid our brothers and sisters in other unions. They took all those rights away. And what occurred was just exactly what Lewis had predicted. An assault on labor, the likes of which we've not seen in this country even in the 1800s.
Lewis's finest strength was the fact that he was a visionary. He was able to anticipate, he was able to look into the future, he was able to change. He had conviction, he stood by what he said was right, regardless of who or how many said he was wrong.
No one can literally replace a man of the immense stature of John L. Lewis. I think that history will, without a doubt, record him as the greatest leader the American labor movement has ever had. And I further think that history will also record him as one of the two or three outstanding Americans of our century.
We have a national record
that looks very poor when laid up against the German national record, the UK national record, the French national record, the Netherlands national record, and the others that I've examined. So I think that I'm not indicting anyone. If anything, I'm indicting myself. I'm indicting an agency that I've been associated with for a long time. We haven't done all that we should have in this field.
God, Frankie, I said the whole midnight shift, and the mine blew up. They're trapped in a mine, and I said Pete's in there too.
I've worked in the mines about 7 years, and I've really never been too scared of the mines. But I don't think I'll go back in the mines.
And the television says, if another explosion would occur, they'd have to seal the mine, and about 1 o'clock that explosion came, and I says, uh-oh, they'll seal.
They sealed them, and then we knew that was it.
The 69 Health and Safety Act is landmark legislation. It followed the tragedy at Farmington, where 78 mine workers were killed in an explosion. The 69 Act didn't come about, however, simply because of that tragedy. Over 100,000 miners have died in the nation's mines since the turn of the century. Their blood helped to write that act. But was it the final victory? Absolutely not. Because no matter how stringent the laws, no matter how all-encompassing the regulations for health and safety may be, unless they're complied with on a regular basis, they're virtually meaningless.
The burdens of flouting the Coal Mine Health and Safety Act are mounting on the Department of the Interior. Miners have been killed in mines which should have been spot inspected, but were not. What are the miners to do when the major governmental institutions fail them, even after a strong law is passed compared with past legislation? All they can do is to go out on wildcat strikes. This is their way of recognizing that the coal industry and the Department of Interior are outside the law, indeed are lawless.
Why is it time for a change in the administration of the UMW right now?
Because the present administration is totally corrupt and totally concerned with maintaining themselves in office in order that they can continue their system of nepotism and the taking care of their friends. They're not interested in the coal miners. They've gotten out of touch with the coal miners. They're more interested in following the operators.
You know, when they asked me how many terms do you want, you know how many terms I told them? I told them. I said, just as long as the supreme being up there gives me the intellect and the health to carry on and the membership elect me to office, that's how many terms I want until I'm 180 years of age.
Now, don't kid this hunky. I've been in this ball game too long. I've seen them steal too many elections. They're not going to get away with that with me. The eyes of America are on this election.
I was shaken up so that and shocked that this tragedy is perhaps as much as his immediate family.
Well, do you know of any reason that anybody would want to kill Mr. Yablonsky?
No.
Did you know if his life might have been in danger?
None.
Any threats, kooks, anything like that?
None whatsoever.
You have no idea how something like that would have happened?
I have no idea, no, sir.
Those were years when there was a great social revolution, if you please, that took place in the entire area of the country where coal mining is a major undertaking or a major industry.
I'm proud of the honor of heading up a slate of rank-and-file candidates for the international offices for rank-and-file miners. We must have a safety program that will guarantee our members a safe journey to and from the mines, not one which accepts that we must lose 200 or 300 men every year in mining. That my commitment is to the rank-and-file miner.
I pronounce you President of United Mine Workers of America.
Congratulations.
I'd like to think that our organization would have democratized itself without murders of Jock Yablonski, his wife and his daughter. I'd like to think that. I'd like to think that our organization could have learned a lesson without paying that kind of price.
Run along, girls. Too bad you can't come with us. Ladies are not welcome here. It's an old miner's belief that if a woman rode in this car down into a coal pit, it would bring bad luck, accident, disaster. The face that launched 1,000 ships would also wreck a coal mine. That's the superstition.
I got the woman coal miner blues. Just like you, I got the right to choose. Chance to make my way, and if you can't stand by me, don't stand in my way.
Well, I worked as just general inside, which was shoveling the rib and rock dust and hanging bradish, setting timbers. Then I went up to the buggy, shuttle car, operated it, and from that I went to miner helper. I've done just about everything in the mines that could be done.
They were harassed pretty heavy when they first came into mines because of old superstitions, because of archaic thinking. And the people that stayed, the women that stayed, were really fighters. Had a lot of grit and a lot of sand. And they brought with them a lot of new, fresh ideas that helped us, that made us a better union.
We must work together to change the things that's wrong. For better conditions, we've waited much too long. Health and safety have to be a first priority, and the change can only come through you and me.
When women start working in the mine, safety conditions tend to improve. The women have, for the most part, been responsible for the upbringing of either their own children or other people's children or brothers or sisters, and they tend to naturally watch out for safety conditions of others. But I think that we're going to find, as more women start working in the mines, safety conditions will improve. The women will see to that.
Mine machinery is something that looks different to what the mines did when you had track cars and you loaded with shovels, because you got nowhere as solid in the mines now with the machinery running. And back then, you didn't hear nothing, only just the ring of a man's shovel or somebody driving an old mule.
Tell me, what will a coal miner do? Tell me, what will a coal miner do when he go down in the mine? Joy, Lord, does he will find. Tell me, what will a coal miner do?
Around the mid-20s, early 30s, but particularly into the 1940s and 50s, that's when we saw what one would say was the cotton gin of coal mining. When those machines came along, they replaced men, because one machine could do what 100 men did by hand loading.
In 1979, I think it was, I had the opportunity to see a longwall in action in Wales. I never will forget the day, because the face of the longwall was about a quarter of a mile long, and it was low coal, about 40-inch coal. But I crawled the whole face. When we come out of the mine, I commented that if they ever come to the United States, that we're going to have a lot more coal production, but a lot less people working. And that became a reality a short time after. Today, with the installation of the longwalls throughout the United States, we're loading more coal than we did 15 years ago with 50% less people. Mechanization of the mines had to come about. You cannot stop progress. But the union takes a position that with the high production due to the mechanization and the fewer people, that we should share in some of the fruits of our labor. So consequently, we negotiate for stronger job security. A training fund was established in order to train the miners that would get laid off due to the mechanization, so they would be fit to go into another job that would pay as well and have the same type of benefits and so forth.
Step off the road, and we'll go back up here, all right?
Don't put your shotgun.
Make sure the ambulance gets through.
The ambulance is going to get through. That's my goddamn people down there. Put your shotguns up. Fair enough.
The labor laws in this country are formulated for labor to lose. And if you play by every one of those rules, you lose every time. So what it forces you to do is to change the way you've operated.
Grumka, AFL-CIO President Lane Kirkland, and the leaders of 19 other major unions were arrested for blocking the courthouse. The charge is obstructing free passage.
Proudest day of my life to be able to say that I lead these people.
The question that every person must answer for himself has got to be, which side are you on?
Yeah! If they come to arrest you, do not resist arrest. This is a peaceful demonstration.
They didn't think that a predominantly white, mountain, rural workforce would ever follow the teachings of Dr. Martin Luther King. But they did.
Dr. King says there's nothing more invigorating than being in jail for a cause that you believe in, and I think that's absolutely right. There's nothing wrong with going to jail when you're trying to change an unjust system or an unjust law.
Dr. King used to talk about illegal injunctions and how if he lived somewhere else, he might understand these kind of injunctions.
But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't gonna let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't gonna let any injunction turn us around.
When the injunctions started coming down and they were issued against us, they ordered me at one point to stop paying strike benefits to our members. Stop providing them with health care. Stop providing them with lawyers to help them when they were charged with things. They ordered me to stop doing that. And we finally came to the conclusion that we should do what was right for the organization. Make the decisions that were necessary to win.
As long as we got people, we're going to keep it up. That's the way we're putting pressure on the counties and on the state. You know, eventually somebody's going to have to take notice that something bad's going on down here and step in and help correct it.
Three high-ranking officials from Europe representing more than 100 million labor union members around the world toured several United Mine Worker picket lines today.
I never thought it would be possible, it would be necessary to be here in the United States on a rally such as this, on the question of trade union rights and a decent deal for the workers.
You are not alone in this struggle. The Pittstons and the Paul Douglases of the world can never divide us. Our solidarity is much stronger than their greed.
Labor Secretary Elizabeth Dole was visibly moved by stories she heard today from striking miners on the picket line at the Moss No. 3 prep plant. She also said she was frustrated by the situation.
We need to get this resolved, and this issue of retiree health benefits clearly is an issue that goes beyond Pittston, goes beyond the coal industry.
Just her being here is positive because it shows we do have movement now in the federal government.
When William Ussery was named the so-called super mediator to settle the lingering coal miner strike on October 25th, he said a settlement could be reached by the holidays. But with Thanksgiving and Christmas behind us and New Year's Day just 2 days away, a sense of urgency has taken over the talks here in Washington.
At the moment, I feel good that we can bring it off. As I said, it's very difficult, very complex, very hard. There's a lot of emotions in it.
We have families. We have bills like everyone else. As soon as the strike's over with, we get back to work and life goes back to normal.
The most thing I probably want is for the strike to be over because Daddy can't get to work and it's terrible.
With hands raised in triumphant celebration, representatives of the United Mine Workers and Pittston Coal emerged from the office of Labor Secretary Elizabeth Dole. This occasion ended 9 months of harsh words and bitter court litigation.
And the question isn't, well, why did you agree to this? No one's agreed to anything until you vote on it. Everybody here now gets to share some of this burden all of us have had to enjoy here for the past 6 or 8 months. You get to decide whether this is something that you like or dislike.
You've made the mine workers a household name across the world. They know about Pittston, and they know about the Pittston struggle. And every one of them takes their hats off to you. Because whenever they told us they were going to take health care away from our grandparents and our dads and our mothers and our kids, we told them that they were not going to do that. And by God, they haven't.
Tell the boys of Pittston that we're here to stay. Tell the boys of Pittston we're the UMWA. Go tell Paul Douglas, go tell my golden crew. We'll not give up on the fight until we've seen through. We're standing here together, as proud as we can be. Tell the boys of Pittston, take this victory. Tell the boys of Pittston, gonna stand our ground. Tell the boys of Pittston, no one will turn us round. That we're here to stay. Tell the boys of Pittston we're the UMWA. Pittston, we're gonna stand our ground. Tell the boys of Pittston, no one will turn us round. Tell the boys of Pittston that we're here to stay. Tell the boys of Pittston we're the UMWA.
We've been educated during this, and I feel like we're not gonna stop now. There's people out there that need help. And we plan on going on with this and keeping it going.
We've learned one thing as a union, we got to stick together.
If you don't unite together and work together, you're not going to be together very long.
We're all union people, we're all labor, and we've got to have international ties and international cooperation, much more than we've had in the past at a new level. And that then gives us the ability to negotiate with these international corporations.
International solidarity plays a very important role in the labor movement today because one must realize that things move very quickly. Recently, I was invited to Russia to the first Democratic Mining Congress that was held in the Soviet Union. I had the opportunity of going underground in a coal mine in Russia as well as visiting a steel mill. The Russians are hungry for knowledge and health and safety, for knowledge in negotiating, for knowledge in structuring unions, and we had pledged support to them, and we'll follow through with it. International solidarity is in the best interest of our membership, because without it, these companies will play one worker against the other worker. They'll come to us and say, we have to cut our wages, we have to cut our medical benefits in order to compete with the third world countries. If we can raise the third world country standards up to ours, we'll all be playing on a level playing field, and we won't have to do any cutting this or cutting that. We'll all move forward.
Rich, as you know, I've been waiting, I think, about 42 years to return this to you.
But today we're changing. We represent more than just coal miners. We represent surface miners in the West and in Western Canada. We represent Hispanics and the Navajos in the Great Southwest. Whether you're driving an ambulance in West Virginia or you're mining coal under the Atlantic Ocean in Nova Scotia, we represent the best that the nations have to offer. And we look forward to the future. We look forward to growth. We look forward to change. And we look forward to the challenges that the 90s will bring.
Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
Come all of you good workers, good news to you out there, of how the good old union is coming here to dwell. Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
If you go to Harlan County, there are no neutrals there. You're either with the union or a thug of James Blair.
Which side are you on? 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 My daddy was a miner, now he's in the air and sun, but he'll be with the union till every battle's won. Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
If you don't want your husband to die in a coal mine, I see you in the morning out on the picket line. Oh, which side are you on? Which side are you on?
Which side are you on? Which side are you on?